It's a great pleasure to have Maria Luisa De Natale here visiting us from the Catholic University of Milan. Maria Luisa De Natale is a recipient of the Paulo Freire Prize in Latin America in Chile.
Yes.
And she will be talking to us about adult education, learning or educating.
Yes.
A comparison, understanding from the English system and the Danish system.
And the actual meaning. We will arrive in the reality of nowadays. So thank you very much. Now we start this this conversation. And first of all, I must say thanks to Alex Guilherme for this invitation, because I enjoy very much to be here with you in this wonderful university, in this wonderful sun you have in England. And more and more because I am invited by Paulo Freire Centrum. This is an important meaning for me and for adult education. And in the second slide, you can see in the first slide, it is my university, the Catholic University in Milan. And the second slide, my students want to put this prize, which the Latin American University in Chile want liked to offer to me. I was honored by this prize, and so my life is more and more linked to Paulo Freire everywhere the world, because I am a Paulo Freire. And in what I want to share with you in this conversation is just the problem, the scientific problem of this adult education. Go on. Because as far as I study adult education, that means all my life, and I am already old now, I find that there are two different meanings. And there is a misunderstanding when one speaks about adult education. Some people think about instruction, about learning education, when we speak adult education. And some people think about education for life, free education, education for human being. And this, I find, is a problem which is nowadays spread over all scientific world, all over the world. It's not only European, it's not only a northern problem, it's a scientific problem. So what is the origin of this different meaning of the same adult education? The origin I could find in my studies in two different conceptions, which come from two different worlds. One word is yours, from England, from Great Britain. Because as far as we go in the origin of adult education, we can see that in England, adult education start really like a movement after the Industrial Revolution, when all the problems which people have invited some good people to offer technical education instruction in order to avoid tapped people. You must excuse my bad English. Is a lot of time I don't speak English. I speak always Italian now. Or Spanish, and this is why we find in England, in the origin in 19th century, we find this movement, which is a private movement, to give instruction to people who comes from country who is unable to defend himself, And going on, of course, running, we find that this adult education is finishing, is going to an education and instruction required for social economic reasons to improve his work, to give better condition of works, of price, of earning. And in the end of 19th century, it ends even in the utopic movement with Owen and so on. And we can quote, I have written books, so all quotation I don't say in this conversation, but you can find in my books. Even there are the mechanic institutes, and we can go far even in the Cartism movement, where we find that Cartism is asking for Britain, for English people, that the schools are opened in the day for children and in the afternoon for adults in order to learn. And we can go in this direction, adult education like instruction for all the century and even in our century. The meaning which start from this country like a movement organized and effective, we must recognize this, is a movement which is intending adult education like instruction for social and economic reasons. But in the 19th century, in the same period, there is another big movement which start in another country, not far from here, in Denmark. And this big movement in adult education was originated by, not by by a group, but by a person, by a philosophy of education. Where are they? We can say the philosophy of education, because this is the movement coming out from a thinker whose name is Nikolai Friedrich Severin Grundtvig. Who is Grundtvig? We say only Grundtvig. Who is recognized all over the world like the father of adult education? And the origin of this movement, which is very well known all over the world, there is the European Community now, which is a program named Grundtvig for adult education, but you can find him very well known in Asia and everywhere because he is from United Nations, recognized like the father of adult education. So this man arrived to adult education by his own biography. He was a philosophy, I said, of education, a philosopher of education, because he was educated like a priest, a Lutheran priest, of course. Denmark is Lutheran, and in the Lutheran Christian faith. And this Lutheran Christian faith, he was a son of a pastor, even the father was a pastor in Lutheran religion. And this Lutheran Christian faith is and a special faith, Cristianesimo Luterano di Penitenza is in Italian, which look at human life on the ground, our life, only in the direction of the other life. The human life is without value, must be lived only thinking of the other one. But fortunately, this man fell in love, and so he discovered that there is a dimension of man, of human being, which cannot be solved in the idea of Christian Lutheranism of penance. And this unhappy love, fortunately it was unhappy, this love. This unhappy love helped him in the beginning to decide to die. You must think that we are in the romantic period, of course, and so all of the background you can imagine. But then, all of a sudden, he went to read Irenaeus' book in the Catholic Church, you know. And he was very impressed by this Christian book because Irenaeus was expressing very well that Jesus Christ dressed human life in order to save people, to save all of us. This is Catholic faith. And so he was running to think that if Jesus Christ took human nature, that means that human life must be lived in all its richness and not must be denied for the other life in after that. And so he started, so I say this is a philosophy of education, but he must still arrive to education. He started to think that his motto is to be more first human and then Christian. That you cannot even live religion and faith if you are not really human. If you are not a human being developed in all your richness with all your dimension, and the dimension of heart was one of the most important because he was suffering for this unhappy love, like I think all of us suffering because it happens to all generally. And this is in this period he started in Denmark to say such thing. He was living like a pastor in the official church. And his idea was that that to become Christian, to live Christianity, must be useful to be a man, to live together, to have the experience how beautiful it is to communicate and to live in a relation and to be happy because man is man in the meaning of human being is was born in order to be happy, not to be suffering and to be mortified in his dimension. The happiness, the joy, is the meaning of human life. Of course, if you think that in Denmark in that period there was Kierkegaard, where are the philosophers? Kierkegaard was just in the opposite corner, and he was expelled by the official church because this joyous, happy Christianity could not be admitted in the Denmark in 19th century. And then he was traveling a lot, was in England, was looking at this adult education model in England. And then three times he was in England and he was going to open himself to education. Because he says what we need in this world is just to educate the people to understand how beautiful it is to be a human being and to educate the adult people, not the young people. The young people must have instruction, but adult people must have an education which is, his definition is enlightenment. That means illuminazione, give light on human life and must be like a reawakening, un risveglio, a call to engagement. because human life is so so nice to be lived. And he was traveling all Denmark because he could not be a pastor. The church, the official church, has put him out. And he was traveling and saying to other people his ideas. What we need, he was saying, is an education for adults, education which has no the reason of having a paper and a title in order to improve our position, but an education which must have the prize in itself. Because the man, the human being who attended this education must be must desire only to live an experience with others, to live an experience, a residential experience. Because to live together, we learn how beautiful it is when we spend all the time together. So the character of this adult education he was dreaming in the beginning, but then was realized, is an education for life. Education which is only to live better. Education for life. And education which can be in a school, school for people, folk oi schooler, is folk is popular, oi is height for adult, schooler. A folkoi schooler where people can go to live some days together, to work together, to discuss together. There must be not a program, must be not a school for that, because he was Lutheran, and of course, you know the Reform, you know the problem with Latin Catholic religion. And he was calling all the Catholic school the school for that, the black school, because were school based on the written word, on the books, and where in the book he says in the written word the soul of the person who is writing is lost. You cannot feel the expression so like it is the word when you are pronouncing it in face of the other. And what is originally in this idea is this method, the method of living words. Adult people can be educated with this aim to enlighten and awake with the method of living words. That means the speaking among with the vivente parola, because otherwise adult people is dead. And is not possible to enlighten, to be enlightened on the beautiful of life and the joy to live, and so on. And what was then important, that some peasant in Denmark in 19th century were all agriculture in the fields, listening to this dream, they opened the folkhoy schooler. And so started the folkhoy schooler movement of adult education in Denmark, in which the old peasant were to spend time together, to decide about what to discuss together, and especially about the tradition of the folk song, the folk story of the people of land. And this move and this experience was so increasing. And the same Grundvig was recalled in the official church. The queen was forgiving his idea of happy Christianity, and he came back to be a Lutheran pastor in the official church. But he did not stop to explain his ideas. And what was interesting in the social life and the democratic life of Denmark was that these peasants in this folkhögskolor discussing about old tradition of their land were able, after these days spent together in a residential school, were able to understand how beautiful it is to be together and to work together. And so in Denmark was born, was originated, the cooperative movement. The cooperative movement was not originated by economic law, but was originated by this folkhögskolor adult education by Grundtvig. And because people learn to be together, to share something. And another important thing, you know, in this century there was the democratic evolution in all nations because of constitution and so on. And this Danish people was becoming, was going to become able to take part to the democratic life of his land. Because one of most famous expression of Grundtvig is no one can be free if his neighbor is not free with him. And this is a very democratic program in one expression. And the neighbor is the peasant who is with me in discussing about old tradition. And this adult education, this education for life, was just in the opposite meaning, as you can see, referred to the adult education movement in Britain, in the motivation, in the realization, in the aims even of this adult education. Adult must go to attend some course, choosing by themselves about what to speak, about what to discuss, with this method of living words, which is an extraordinary method, and with this idea to understand how to live better. The aim for each one of us, for us all, is always to be happy. And the happiness, where I can find happiness, is a normal aim for all human beings, the research of happiness. And so the movement in Denmark was going so far and so successful that the Ministry of Education understood that they could not lose this occasion for the people. And even if folkhögskolor movement was originated by private, by peasant who were offering their fazenda, no, farm, to open a folkhögskolor, even if this was the origin, like the same origin in of the other meaning extraction, because even there were private for charity. In England there were the charity school, the Sunday school, all the movements was very, very well known, I think. We are in England now, no, in Great Britain. And even, but in England, the instruction movement remained a private initiative. While in Denmark, this education for life in the end of 19th century was kept in the education of was kept in the education of system, in the system of education of the ministry, because and so it is going until now with many differences. There are books, there are computer and so on, of course, but the idea is to spend some time just to educate, not to follow an education which must have a paper or some recompense or some retribution outside ourselves. This must be the motivation to go to attend a folk Højskoler in Denmark. So these two meanings, as far as I can find, are the two meanings which originated the adult education, for which when we think about adult education, we think different things, instruction or education. If we go to the beginning of the new century, the 20th century, we find, of course, two world wars and so many problems. And in the end of these two mondial world war, we have a new mondial organization, UNESCO, who took into account the adult education. UNESCO, which is the organization of United Nations, you know, United Nations Education, Science, Culture Organization, this is UNESCO. UNESCO in 1949 decided to, quindi after the Second World War, decided to take into account adult education in the meaning of instruction, because the reason for which UNESCO wanted to invite this international conference, mondial conference, was because during the war many young people did not attend school, so they were called for war, and so they had to finish their curricula, their papers. But what happened in this first mondial conference in 1949, which took place in Elsinore? Elsinore is a little village close to Copenhagen, and it was the signum that the signum. Do you understand the signum? The il segno, a sign, a proof that this mondial conference we take in Elsinore in Copenhagen, 20 kilometers from Copenhagen, because in Denmark adult education is in the governmental law, is the only nation in which you find in the end of 19th century adult education system with folk Højskoler, Grundtvigian. And during this conference, it started to be clear that adult education, like instruction, is not sufficient because the world was changing very quick. And the second world conference was in 1960 in Montreal, in Canada. And this mondial world conference start to clarify that it is impossible to think of adult education in the meaning of instruction or education for life. Education must be only one. Education is a process, you can read in the documents of this mondial conference, is only a process in which is accompanying you all your life. That means that in 1960 we have the declaration of what we call lifelong education, or in a bad translation, permanent education. Because even the most acculturated people, for instance, teachers in university, they need education. Because in 1960, if you remind, you cannot remind because you are too young, but in 1960, world was changing quickly. There is the economic progress, the reconstruction of town and work and well-being and everything, and the changing of social life through communication. The way of communicating is changing our life, like we see nowadays, no? It is evident. And so I can tell you that in the year, I can sure tell you that in the year between 60 and 2000, in the beginning of this new century, we lived 40 years, very interesting for adult education, because we could find an effort by all international organization national organization to start a new beginning of the history of pedagogy, to define in a different method, in a different way, what education is. What is education? Because if education is no more to prepare young people to live in the second moment of their life, but if education, like we read in 1960 documents, is a process which accompany myself all along all my life, of course we must define better what is education in itself, and how it is distinguished by instruction, even if the one called the other, of course, is distinguished but not separated by instruction, but cannot be identified. And I must say that in these 40 years of the last century was very active in Europe, the council coming back to Europe, because of course we can study other continents, we can study, for instance, the thought of Paulo Freire. Paulo Freire was arriving to the same idea of education, but starting from social political reasons. But he started to define in Brazil, in Chile, where he was working a lot, and in all South America, and then in Switzerland, because he was expelled by Latin America. And in the 70 was in Switzerland, here more or less I have written. But it was the period in which he was in Switzerland. And from Switzerland he can spread over his idea on adult education, in which he take together instruction and education. Because the aim of instruction and the aim of education is to become conscious of his own life, of his own duty, and of his engagement. In the Grundtvig language, awakening to be engaged, no? Grundtvig was more poetic a century before. But I was saying to you that in these 40 years, from 1960 until 20th century, until 21st century, the end of century, there was this organization very active in Europe. There was the Council for Cultural Cooperation, otherwise CCC, the Council for Cultural Cooperation in Strasbourg. In Strasbourg, there was not yet Europe, no, like unity, you know, I think, but there was just the idea to go towards Europe. a common Europe. And in this Council for Cultural Cooperation, put out in a special office named Out of School Education, with the direction of an Austrian people, a wonderful, wonderful person, indeed enlightened man. And this Herbert Jocker was the name. And Herbert Jocker, with his group, with the Council for Cultural Cooperation, was going all over Europe, finding the best practice in permanent education, just to know and to define what education is now, this new education which is required to a man, to a citizen of this end of century, which must put together instruction and enlightenment and education for life. And we have a lot of nice experience if you want to go to study the activity of the Council for Cultural Cooperation in Europe, of course, in Europe. But in England too, they even the Roskilde was in Denmark, even some new university were found in this new meaning of education. I was saying, I don't know if you know Roskilde University, close to Copenhagen, which is a model for a different university. But just not to lose our conversation, what happens then in adult education in the beginning of this new century? What I see now? I see that from 2000, you know, with the unity of Europe, the community and so on, we have a lot of documents in which adult education has the first position for the government. But why has the first position in the government? Lisbona conference, if you know some of these Copenhagen documents, all the conference of the Ministry of Education, the documents are so many. And what is the idea that a community now is spreading off? Education is instruction, worse than instruction. Adult education is worse than only instruction. Is all what is necessary to people to increase competition, to increase in the knowledge society, to aumentare to get more and more knowledge in with more and more science experience, just to be competitive, just to be the first, just to be people who can fight against the world power from America, from Asia, because comes economic power from China and from Japan for technology. No, you know, we are just some years ago, and even this year documents. And so the recommendation and all the European policy, as far as I can read, can understand, seems to forget the education for life in order to stress what is necessary to men to become homo economicus, fighting against the others and winning and to become winner in the competition among production. Economic production and social production. This is really a problem which we are. in which we are. Adult education in the meaning of education for life is no more. Is no more quoted by anyone. Is just an illusion. Is lost time. Is an occasion for free time, but is not education. In the consideration of government, in the consideration of policy of education nowadays in all government. I was discussing this morning even with you as a vice chancellor, and he was with this idea, he agreed with me, we were discussing about this. And so, of course, we live in this humanity in which we say more and more violence, war, racism, intolerance, and a lot of situations we register every day. Gender violence. In Italy now we have a lot of gender violence. From the beginning of the year, there are already more than 50 women killed by their lovers. And so on. So what we can do in such a situation? What we can do? What I think we can do, I think that is necessary that in the world of the research, which is our world, the world of university, we start to study adult education like a scientific subject. Not only like a practice activities to help people. It's a scientific branch of our research. Which is, and for this, university are deaf to start with this scientific research. Subject on adult education again. But I think that is a need. In Chile, where I put the prize, last year I was invited for the Lectio Magistralis because for the first time, 2013, April, was starting the first subject in a university like a scientific subject, adult education in Repubblica del Cile, 2013, the first SIGE. In Italy we have a lot of SIGE, but no one is studying adult education. There is the name, but they do different things. And my colleague, stop, I cannot speak more. But because they don't believe in adult education. You must believe in adult education to make it a subject of research and the scientific research. You must leave adult education if you want to not to lose the speranza, the hope in a better world and to become a protagonist of a better world. And so what I think is that in the moment we are just in a situation in which we have to start with a new beginning for adult education. I was very happy to be invited by Paulo Freire group here because as I expressed to your decano and dean and vice chancellor. I hope that in this university I could see a chair for adult education like I saw in Valparaiso in Chile last year after many years of work together because the first time I was there was 2006. Now, of course, we start now in this, but it is a good beginning with Paulo Freire Center, of course, because it is a way in which we can, in this centrum, I think, in which we can find themselves like adults, independent from philosophy, pedagogy, or technical instruction, or operating very important technological things. And we can find ourselves with our humanity. And with the same wish to be happy, to follow not the myth of happiness, which are money, which are success, which are work successful, but with the reality of a human being who could realize themselves. And now I myself, I have an hope. Because in these last days, just last days, months, I can be, it is too much, I am speaking too much. In these last months, I can studying, I am studying, because I go on in studying, of course, in spite of age, because lifelong education is not far from lifelong learning. They must be together, so we must study all our life. And I am studying a very interesting perspective which comes from the United States. The perspective of Martha Nussbaum. Who know her? Who know? Some of you know, you know. Very good. This woman, first because she's a woman. This is a gender qualification. But this Martha Nussbaum is among the 100 women intellectual more important in the world, is written so. She was working in United States and in India, of course. And she worked with Mahirta Sen, you know, the Nobel Prize for Economy. And who start with the microcredito, you know, it was a Nobel Prize for microcredito. And she started with a very interesting theory now. Is a philosopher, she is a philosopher. That the development of a nation depends not only by PIL, you know PIL, internal product lordo, economic PIL.
GDP?
Questo qua, insomma. Not by the PIL, quello là. but by the human potential. And so she from philosophy worked in economy and now become a pedagogist of adult, pedagogist of adult, of adult education. And she wrote about a capability approach, which is very interesting indeed in this. Do you know capability approach? You know. You are studying philosophy. Capability approach means that each human being has some capabilities which we have to, through education and so through instruction, to throw out. Because if the person, and she says through art, through beauty, to work, to common life. You see, come back many meanings we spend already. If we have this, if we could to educate this capability in each man, in each human being, if we can educate this capability, we will have more happy people. And these more happy people who is able to realize himself or herself could be able to live together to the others And we can put end to racism, violence, and all bad things we see in our world. It is not necessary to make the elenco. And this is the recommendation she put to all nations now, that we have to use capability approach, which is a pedagogical approach, an educational approach, an adult educational approach, in order to develop human being and to increase the development of a nation and economic development of a nation. Even Obama is listening very much to this proposal nowadays, and all America, because she is teaching in Chicago. And of course, this is a new hope, I was saying to you, because she has the courage to say that to have an economic approach, develop, like is the problem all over the world nowadays, no? You know, we are underdeveloped by economic problem. We must study classic culture. Platone, Aristotle, and all classic culture. And we must learn beauty. We must live in beauty. This morning we were saying, and so many other things, because otherwise our future is not a future, is only a fear, paura, yeah. A fear of a complete death of humanity, which is in each human being. And so I see in this century in which we live, I see that this voice, which is so much heard, because all people is very much impressed in all nation by Martha Nussbaum, maybe we have an hope to go on to increase, to found indeed an adult education, not movement, not system, but a real adult education for getting again the idea, the Grundtvigian idea, that humanity is so beautiful and must be lived in all richness of the gift which each one of human being has, and which in adult life we become conscious to recognize what we have and what we must do for ourselves and for the others. It was the idea of awakening of Grundtvig, of engagement, and is now the idea of Nussbaum for increase the economic life and PIL, prodotto interno lordo in Italian. So I finish this one. Okay.
Could you just say a little bit more about the folk school, about the nationalistic aspect? Because as I understand, part of it was that there was a threat in Denmark from German culture seeping in, and you know, the Danes at the time thought that the folk school could help put a stop into that, you know, like of yes. German culture seeping in and then taking over, especially the southern parts.
Yes, yes, you know, between German and the Danish people there is always a competition. I was living in Denmark when I was young, and so I know very well. I was living for study Grundtvig. And there is this competition very strong, of course, but one of the effects of this Folkhögskolor was just this. That people in Folkhögskolor start to arrive to spend 3 days together, so to cook and to eat together, and then in the room to sleep, not together, if but each one with. and what was one of the results of this school? That people start to love his land. Because about what we discuss about proverbs, about old history, legend, mythology of our land. And so they start to love, I use this verb, to love his own land. And to become nationalist is not correct, I think, like yeah, term. To become conscious of the value to be a land. To be un popolo, a people, to the dimension I wrote in my book, because I wrote, of course, a book on Grundtvig, published by the Danish government, and in Italian, but I wrote in Italian when many, where you was not born. And then this love for their own nation was becoming strong and stronger because they were singing the traditional songs, for instance. And what was really Grundtvigian, he was stressing very much, was the dialect, the popular language. You must love and speak your popular language, he was saying. And you must sing together, the song, the folk song together. You must make the experience to live in a folk schooler, which is a wonderful experience. And of course, this make the people getting together and to discover the feeling to belong to, belonging to some common reality. When the relation with the German people was always fighting from the past. During the Second World War, what is typical of this relation is that the German people invited, no, Nazism, Hitler, and so on, the Danish, and the only in the history of this historic period, Denmark decided soon not to fight against German. They decided not to fight, not to white flag, and accepted German people in their invasion, of course, political and military invasion, and the German people went to Volkhochschuler and was very impressed by this Volkhochschuler. In fact, they tried then to copy this movement, Volkshochschulen they call in German, but they did not succeed. No one can succeed in copying because there is some typical way of living together in Denmark which cannot be copied. And of course, each nation has its own history and culture and tradition, and it is not to copy. And so what they say in Denmark, they are very proud about this because they say that the winner Germany was won by the Danish education, by the Danish adult education, because indeed the Germans were never in fighting, no people die, nothing happened because Denmark was just so. And while during the period of occupation, German soldiers were there, of course German learned, even Buber learned a lot by Danish culture and Danish living world and Danish way of putting themselves together and discussing and so on. And in a way, there are some critical studies. There was an English who studied very well Grundtvigian system in Denmark, Now I have the name, because this morning I forget. Noel Davis. Noel Davis has written an interesting book on Grundtvig here, in she is from England. While in French, the most important is Erika Simon, a French professor from Lyon, who studied this system. But you find in the book such things. Now, what we can share is that, of course, German were saying that Danish were nationalist, because the meaning of belonging to our land was lived by German people like nationalism. But culturally, I can say that is not so, is not nationalism, because the Danish people, they are open to all people, very much open, and they say we are rich only in education and culture. We cannot, our richness is only in this, and this belonging to them, like a second blood, no? Yes, you understand. So I don't think we can accept, I defend my land, my second land, Denmark, this nationalism. Have you any other small questions?
Any other questions?
Sì, prego.
My one question, this was really interesting. My one question is around this dichotomy, this division that you suggested between England.
Sì, sì.
And I wonder, have you considered, or did Grundtvig look at the English system? There is an English system that's pre-industrial, particularly the work of some of the founders of Sunday school movement in the 18th century, people like Hannah Moore, who was very active not only in education for children but also adult education, and was also a social reformer, so she was interested in things like setting up communal bread ovens for villages so that everyone could get together and bake their bread together. And this was something that she saw as being part of the social revival. Various things kind of get in the way of that, one of which is the Napoleonic Wars. During the Napoleonic Wars, England becomes a very repressive kind of state, and they become quite suspicious of cooperative movements because they seem a lot like the kind of French revolutionary movements. So there's this strange situation where the Sunday school movement actually comes under government surveillance during the late 18th or 19th century. But there's a pre-industrial history, I think, of adult education in England as well.
Yes, yes. If we say pre-industrial adult education, we can find very far, because we can say that the real adult education, our many books write and many professors writes, start with the beginning of humanity, because when there was the Christian who wanted to make their apostolo, and they were speaking to adult people. And there were, of course, in England I found, because I studied a lot your system, I found the Sunday school, the charity school, even in the period in which there was before the Industrial Revolution. But what about the Napoleon period? I don't know. I have not idea about this in England. But what I can tell you is that when Grundtvig was visiting three times England, he was looking at the disaster of Industrial Revolution, the work of women, of children, the poverty of the people, the lacking of everything, and in the last, and of course during the period which we know very well from Marx's analysis, and the second in the last journey. It was almost 50 something in 19th century. He thought the utopian, the Owen realization, the utopic movement in England, and was very impressed by this utopic movement. This is true. This is true because he writes in his Udvalgskrifter, that means he did not write systematic books. But you can find that there is a Grundtvigian library now in Copenhagen, close Town Hall, the Centrum, in which you find many gigantic book which are written, chosen, scritti, scelti, Udvalgskrifter in Danish, in Italian, scritti, scelti, in English, selected the writings by Grundtvig, because he was writing impression and so on. And you can find the impression, if you read Danish, you can find the impression on this English movement. He, in every case, his idea on adult education was originating by the visit to England. This is true. Each one of us who studied, because in the world we know each other even from Eastern country and so, he was impressed by English. Referred to the cooperative movement, what we are, you know, I am not an economist, but what we find, and that the cooperative Danish movement was originated, but this popolo agrario, this peasant, who after a cursus in Folkhøyskolen, decide to put together, to share the production of butter, of milk. This was their economy in the period. And even now it's very good Danish butter. And they start with this, which then will become a cooperative movement. I can tell you my personal experience when I was traveling in all these Folkhøyskoler in 1976, and we were obliged to visit this Folkhøyskoler to live the life of Folkhøyskoler, we guest. And so in the morning we were obliged, for instance, we have a room where to stay some days, and I was speaking with people, discussing with people. I was enjoying very much in order to understand. And I found many times with people who was economists and who were there thinking that to learn something about economy, cooperative appeal, these such things. And then they come to me and say, but what we learn here? Because these people is thinking together. You must not avoid to think. If you are in a Folkhøyskoler in the morning, they put to you a book with the page, and in Danish you must think with the others without understanding any words, maybe. But you must think. You cannot be silent, otherwise you go out. Is a common life, lived, experienced. So what I and this other guest, we were discussing with the responsible of Folkhøyskoler, but from where was born this cooperative movement. And they explained us that the cooperative was not suggested by economic law or rules, but was suggested by the pleasure to share even this, after we share this nice week together, to share even this. In the origin, of course, now is everything is changed, of course. There are still folkhögskolor, for instance, Danish government oblige, if you are in, in cassa integrazione, cassa integrazione is an economic problem, if you work. I am the leader of the azienda. And then I say to you, you don't work anymore for the economic conquest. I must pay to you a cassa integrazione, half of your monthly earning, without you work. Do you understand? No. What is?
Employment compensation.
Ah, employment, perfetto. Employment compensation. When they had this employment compensation in when I was there in the 80s, then I came back many times in to Denmark. In the 80s start this employment compensation, and the government obliged these people with employed to go to attend to folkhögskola in order to prevent depression and criminality and other things, of course. And they are now this adult education, like education for life in the Danish system, are an occasion of education for all people. And you find, for instance, even some people, some tribunali in the court judgment, if a wife and husband ask to separate, to divorce, they invited sometimes to spend a period in folkhögskola together with children, just to see if the family can be saved.
If it's being asked to take in people who have been sent there by the courts or sent there because they're unemployed, does that not create a problem for the, because the whole point of the movement is supposed to be people choose to be there, they choose to commit themselves to that? Right?
Yes.
Does that create a problem for these
people? Yes. Now the life changed, even in Denmark, of course, and so they are in the system because they are no more selected, they are in the system, and of course you can choose, they are even specialized. You can choose a folkhögskola because the other experience very important I miss to say is that in this common experience you must do something practice, not only discussing with the living words, but you must have some practice activities. For instance, there are some folkhögskola where you can work ceramic. One I was very much impressed because I remember Pompeii, you know, my cool culture, southern Italian culture. And there were some women who were enjoying themselves preparing and colorating dress, how to do celeste, pink, and so on, the different color of dress was very interesting. And then there are now men, young boy, who like to do some experience with computer, because now there are books, there are computer, there are video, of course, is no more only the living world, but even succeeding and so on. But remain the system. If you want to be a teacher in this, you can be a teacher. They don't ask any document if you want to be a teacher in this folkhögskola. The only things you must have experienced, they say, life. It's not easy. I was invited many times to be a teacher there of Italian, for Italian, because they find I have a living word. They are, you have a living word, you can be a teacher in our folk high schooler, but I did not accept. My street was another, my way was a different one. But indeed, I think that they are not very well known, especially in British countries. They are not well known, Danish folk school, while in America, United States, they are very well known, and in the Eastern. There was a century after Grundtvig, I was telling to my friend, there was a meeting in the Parliament of Copenhagen, and they invited people from all the world, each one for one nation. And I myself was so surprised to learn so much. India knows very well. Where is India, your friend? They know very well Grundtvig and the Danish experience, for instance. And even in China nowadays, and from United States, they have already in the year in which I was traveling in Denmark, they call Scandinavian seminar. They sent people from United States to Scandinavian to Denmark in order to live this experience of education for life. But what I mean, what I see in the foreseen, that this idea of Nussbaum will take again the idea to discover this movement, because it's a need of our situation nowadays. And I hope that I will be invited again in Hope Liverpool University for the inauguration for the Lectio Magistralis of the first chair in adult education curriculum.
I'm just getting conscious of the time because it's 4:30, so I think we need to leave there. Thanks so much, Maria Luisa.
No problem, no problem at all, no problem. Thank you to you very much.